So I needed to rotate this plant here. Figured it would be the best and easiest way to get it tied to this pole. So I had to take this cover off, and it was a good opportunity to show some of the growth. I planted this plant and the plant in the back there about a month, 4 to 6 weeks after these plants. They're different species. The ones in the back are smaller tomatoes. These are called black pear, and these are called stew peach, something like that. These ones in the front are marvel striped tomato. They produce large tomatoes. It's an heirloom seed, and they're funky shaped, and they have purple and green stripes. If I take the lids off these two in the back, the roots are just ridiculous. You can't even see any of the grow media. It's totally covered. The bucket's just filled with roots. But on this one, you can see the kind of the whole plant. It's very interesting. You can see stem comes down. This was a cutting. It's got all kinds of roots forming higher and higher up the stem. They fan out radially going down into these lava rocks. Lava rocks are good, but they're very porous, and when the root tip hits a lot of them, it tries to burrow into the rock and hits a dead end. So it's good and it's bad. I mean, the roots really dig in pretty well. I'm not sure how deep they go. So far, so good. The plants are, you know, totally thriving. And then you can see here that some of the main roots extend outwards. And then when you see them do this here, those little ones that are branching out from the main root are called feeder roots. And they, it's an order of magnitude higher in surface area. Once the, I'm pretty sure that happens once they go into fruiting. When fruits and flowers start being produced, or maybe about 2 weeks before then, they'll start putting these feeder roots out in preparation. I'll show this one here. This one's a beast. There's the stem going in. It's just full of roots. So I just finished tying up my plants. Figured now would be a good time to do a update. Today is July 22nd. The plants in the back here were planted on May 27th. At the same time as some pepper plants. This pepper plant and this pepper plant were planted in these two buckets up front. But they weren't doing too well in the buckets. They're still not doing great. I'm not sure what I'm doing wrong. This one on the left is doing well. But anyway, they weren't doing well in the buckets. So I've taken them out of the buckets. And I replaced them with some cuttings from my organic garden. The tomato is called marvel striped tomato. So these two in front are the marble striped tomato. This one here back right is stew peas. They make these nice, they're fruiting. They make these nice small to mid-sized globe tomatoes. I've never grown them before. The description said that it's prolific, which means that it grows a lot of tomatoes, and I believe that to be true so far. I haven't done much pruning. I've tried to keep the pruning to a minimum. But right now I've got like tons of blossom clusters and quite a few clusters of maturing fruit. So I'm really happy with this plant, and I'm really happy with the hydroponic system overall. I just added these posts here in the front, made out of conduit, in preparation for the monster tomatoes that these will start producing soon. I've already got some on this plant here. The nice thing about the Dutch bucket system, or the aeroponics bucket system, one nice thing about it, there's a lot of good things about it. This plant here in the back, the shape of it was problematic. It's got these three forks down at the bottom. And then the one on the right has its own thing going on. And this whole plant was rotated at about 100 degrees clockwise from what you're looking at right now. And I couldn't tie it up on this post. But with the Dutch buckets, I just took the lid off and I was able to rotate the whole plant without disturbing anything. Looks really good. Okay, back left is the black pear tomato. It also has some fruits forming. You can almost see some color starting to appear. I'm not sure how big these gets. I think they're fairly small. Also prolific. I've got clusters of fruit and not quite as many blossoms, but definitely a lot of blossoms also. Both these plants in the back here will probably continue producing fruit for, I don't know. It's my first time growing them, but I'm thinking at least a month, maybe 2 months. It should be noted that I had just messed with these plants yesterday. They were getting heavy, and I didn't have them tied up very much at all. So I had to retie them up. I added supports to the right and left, and I basically like fanned out all the growth because it was pretty. It was starting to hang over the edge of the bucket towards the ground. So I lifted them up and I just fanned them out. So the plants look about twice as big as they did yesterday. And a lot of that growth up top, it has small leaves, but I'm thinking that now that it can breathe more and it's covering more area, those leaves will get bigger, the plants will start to get more energy. Also, the sun has been real strong over the past week. Until this week, we've had some pretty crappy weather, but the sun's real strong. Plants have just been sucking up nutrients. So I think if I keep the pH down, the plants are just going to keep on growing. I'm loving this system so far. So I'll give a look at the roots. This one in the back left is my favorite. It's got just an absurd amount of roots. Okay, so these are the black pear tomatoes. I ordered these plants from chiliplants.com. They came in the mail. Just a small twig, and now they're massive. Alright, so here's the roots. You can hardly see the grow medium. I'm trying to get it. There's the lava rocks, which I'm growing on. All those small feeder roots. There's the big stalk in the middle there. And just roots fanning out in all directions. What you're seeing up top here is some rock dust. I sprinkled some azomite on these roots up top. Figured it would trickle down. Couldn't hurt. Oh, I've never described the system. Let me describe it. You can see the black lines, these black tubes. It has a silicone inner tube, and then I covered it with these black sheaths. The reason I covered it with the black material is to prevent light from penetrating the tubes. About 3 weeks into the grow, I experienced a problem because the tubes were growing algae inside and the nozzles got clogged. So I had to basically disconnect the whole system, and I flushed the whole thing out with some bleach and then cleaned it. Then I flushed it with some hot boiling water, flushed out all the tubes, and then reconnected everything. And then when I reconnected it, I added these black sheets. So the plants are grown in the lava rock, which I've shown in the previous video, and they have these nice sprayers on the bucket lid. They're installed right here, and they just make this nice 90 degree fan of fine spray, and the system is programmed to kick on once every hour for 30 seconds. In 30 seconds, the buckets and the roots and the rocks get sprayed down, starting from the top, and then after 30 seconds it kicks off, and all of the solution drips down through the rocks, down these drain pipes, which are at a slight tilt, and then drips out of a hole at the bottom into another pipe that I have installed, which acts as a reservoir or a drainage bay. I'm not sure how fancy I want to get with the name, but all the water that drains out of the system accumulates in this pipe over a time period of 15 minutes. It actually takes a surprisingly long time for all the water to make its way down to the reservoir. So once that happens, a second pump kicks on and sucks all the fluid back into the reservoir, which I keep inside because keeping it outside, it might grow some kind of bad bacteria, or I was thinking mosquito larvae will probably be a bigger problem than anything else. So I keep that inside, and it enables me to mix up all the fertilizer in the comfort of my own home. So with the, I call these the aeroponics buckets, and with this system, there's a couple things that are different. First off, the feeding solution is more aerated. The roots are exposed to mostly air throughout the course of the day, so they have plenty of oxygen. Furthermore, the buckets collect heat. That's always a problem with the Dutch bucket system, is that the buckets will start to heat up. That's why I have this reflective tape on it. But the buckets will heat up, and that'll create positive convection currents upwards because heat rises. Since the drainage pipe is not sealed and it's lower, I end up with air currents sucking up through the bottom. It flows from the bottom of the bucket up towards the stem. So through the hottest hours of the day, these buckets stay totally aerated, which I think the plants really like. If you look at the lid of the bucket, I've got these grommets. I was thinking of putting basil or something in there in the beginning, but the tomatoes are definitely plenty, and so that just allows for more airflow. What else? Oh, also I have these pepper plants. This one on the left here is doing really well. It's a Hinkle Hat. Hinkle Hats with a Z. I tried the first pepper last week. It was extremely hot, and I liked it very much. This is also a Hinkle Hat. I removed this from the buckets about a month ago, and I think it has a fungal infection down here by the stem. It doesn't look very happy. It has tons of peppers on it though, so I'm not sure what's going to happen with this one. I keep spraying it down with calcium nitrate. Hopefully it'll pull through. I'm growing these two here on the left in the coco coir, and I have I tapped into the nutrient system, and I have a drip line going each of these. It's an awesome thing about my particular setup, which I'm driving with the peristaltic pumps, because they can generate about 20 psi, 20 or 30 psi. So I have this nice thick input tube, which is about 3/16 ID, and all of my nozzles have a real, like a pinhole. It's about a 1/32 ID hole. So the feeding lines are always under back pressure. It means I get even spray out of every nozzle in the system. So it was really quick and easy for me to just tee off this tube here and feed my plants. On the right hand side is a Carolina cayenne pepper plant. It's doing real well. This plant was sickly about 3 weeks ago. This plant was totally thriving, and now they've switched. I don't know what's going on. So hopefully I'll have some cayenne peppers too this summer. I think that's about it. Oh, and I also have this basil plant here. I'm experimenting with just different ways to make the most out of the system. You know, everyone talks about container gardening. These 2-liter bottles are pretty much free, so I cut a section out of the top of it, put a cap on the end, filled it with some mulch, and a bunch of other stuff I had laying around. I had some extra expanded clay pellets. I threw those in there. You know, just anything. It would have worked great with just some mulch. And I made a hole at the bottom left, and I drilled a hole through this PVC drain pipe. So this is also connected to the system. Any water that sprays in from the right hand side eventually makes its way to the left and back into the drain. Oh, by the way, this entire system on the hottest days consumes less than 3 gallons. 3 gallons of water. That's with these two massive plants in the back. You know, maybe by the end of the summer I'll be looking at like 4 or 5 gallons a day. Not bad when you consider the amount of food that this thing produces. Talk a little bit about the construction. I built it this way for three reasons. One is I was working with a pretty limited budget. Two, I used parts which are widely available and reproducible. And three, this can be built pretty much anywhere on any kind of terrain. I started off by installing my drain flanges in the buckets. Then I put in these 2x4 pedestals. The way I built those was just by cutting 4 1-foot long legs. And then I made these little doorstop looking pieces as spacers and just nailed it all together. On the right hand side I jacked them up with some extra scrap wood. On the left hand side there's nothing underneath it, so there's a slight tilt to the left. Once those were together, I rested the buckets on top works real nice because there's a lip on the bottom side of the bucket, so it won't slide off. Once those were on top, I filled it with my rocks, which weighs about 15 pounds per bucket. And then I strapped them down with basically like a tent stake system. So each bucket has four lines extending downward and radially, and they loop through these eyelets, which in my case, I just used some short eyelets and drove the bolts between the cracks in my patio, which worked awesome. It was like totally rigid. And then I tied some Bear Grylls knots, made sure they were really tight, and those buckets are not going anywhere. They're totally secured, because the rope adds a force downwards along with the weight of the bucket, and then the ground exerts a normal force upwards, so it totally captivates the buckets. You know, and you can use some long poles and install this just on the ground pretty much anywhere. So it's a really nice system. The entire system, excluding the pumps, you know, everything I needed to do it except for the pumps, I spent about $400. But this is in Suffolk County, New York. The prices are atrocious out here. I'm not sure what it would have cost me somewhere else. Could have been less than half that. But it was worth it. I think I'll probably break even with the amount of food that I'll get out of this. And more importantly, it was a learning experience. Oh, perfect. Sprinklers just kicked on. Perfect way to end the video. All right, thanks for watching.